Hey readers and writers, I'm Adrian Buskey, and you're listening to Fictitious, a podcast about the storytelling craft of science fiction and fantasy. In this episode, I'm joined by Mary E. Pearson, New York Times bestselling author of the Remnant Chronicles trilogy. Last year, she released the young adult fantasy novel Dance of Thieves, which is set in the Remnant universe, and now she's following up with its sequel, Vow of Thieves. Sparks fly in this new series when a reformed thief turned Queen's Guard becomes reluctant allies with the leader of an outlaw family on the edge of the kingdom. A turbulent romance tests their individual loyalties even as greater insidious threats loom over everything they hold dear. A Fierce Reads title, Vow of Thieves, arrives August 6th from Henry Holt & Company. And Mary, welcome to Fictitious.
Hello, Adrian. It's so nice to be here, and thank you for having me.
Yeah, well, I'm excited to have you on the show because at San Diego Comic Con in 2018, I was on a panel with you and Jason Denzel and Todi Anayemi and Robert Jackson Bennett and R.F. Kuang. And we had just a brilliant time on stage talking about blazing new trails in fantasy and how to take the genre to new heights and explore new areas of it. And it was a really great discussion. And I've had Jason and Rebecca and Robert all on the show. And so I'm kind of like trying to like complete the set. And so you're the next one in there. So I'm really happy to have you on here.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah, it was a great panel. I really enjoyed it.
At that point, you were promoting Dance of Thieves. And now Vow of Thieves is, at the time of the release of this episode, should be about to hit stores. And so right there, I mean, like you're like right on schedule. I mean, you're a prolific author. You have a big backlog of things. How many books is this now for you?
This is number 13. So yeah, I've been really putting the pedal to the metal for quite some time. You know, deadlines, especially on really big fantasy books, you know, they're tough. But yay, I made it.
I mean, they're pretty significantly sized novels. And to be able to get, one a year out of those things is really, really impressive. Can you kind of explain more what this particular series with Dance of Thieves and Vow of Thieves, like what this story is really about?
It's really difficult. I was just talking to another author about this, to talk about sequels, because they're spoilers for the what happened in the first book. But I will talk a little bit about Dance of Thieves and give you a glimpse of Vow of Thieves. But Dance of Thieves, briefly, is about a former street thief. And she's now trained as a premier soldier, and she's sent to unlock the secrets of this outlaw dynasty, which is very far away from where she lives. And then in a twist of events, she finds herself chained to the young leader of this dynasty. They're running from a mutual enemy, so they have to depend upon each other for survival, but they're still keeping secrets from each other because they each have their own goals and motives. But in the process of all of this, as they're working to stay alive, stuff happens. And they discover things about each other that they hadn't considered before. So it follows an enemy to lovers trope, but I think it's about a lot more than that. You know, it's a very layered story about loss and love and family. Jase has a big family, so they play heavily into it, and sisterhood, and about wounds that never heal, preconceptions that we have about people. And that kind of just gets knocked out of the ballpark when Jase and Cassie have to literally walk in each other's footsteps. So the story ends on a slight twist. And of course, that twist is what kicks off Vow of Thieves. And anything else I say, I'm afraid, would be a spoiler for Dance of Thieves. But the sequel continues with the idea that people are not always what they seem to be. That theme is kind of on steroids in this book. You never know who to trust. And I had so much fun with that.
When I got the arc for Vow, I posted about it on Instagram. And I always just like, after my own thoughts, I tag it with a description of the book, usually just taken directly from the marketing materials. And I posted that in there and immediately was like, oh my gosh, I have to throw a huge spoiler warning on this, because if people haven't read the first one,
right.
I mean, just the first sentence gives away something massive, about,
right.
about that first story. And it is really challenging. And I, with movies, you expect like when a trailer for the next one to come out, like, you know, it's like, well, I didn't see the first one 3 years ago. That's on me, right? But
right,
with books,
right.
Sometimes it takes longer for people to get to them, especially in longer series. And people, wait until there's a second or third book out before they dive into it or something, So it's like
right.
just trying to be very, very careful. And I hate spoilers. So like, I always try to stay away from those as much as possible. So we will do our level best to not blow it for people who are discovering the series for the first time. But I mean, there is always going to be the chance that we're going to talk about some things that are going to give a little bit away. So people listening to that, be aware there, mild spoilers could occur somewhere in here. But what is the significance of the titles? I think you maybe alluded to it a little bit there when you're talking about all those layers of, and the complex relationships. But between Dance of Thieves and Vow of Thieves, like, what do those titles really signify?
As I mentioned, Cassie is a former street thief, and even though she's now a soldier, she still uses all those skills throughout both books that she learned a long time ago in the streets of Venda. She and also the other kingdoms on this continent see Jase as a thief too, because what they perceive as his family extorting the town of Hell's Mouth, which they sort of oversee, and skimming its merchants. But they don't know the whole story. But to them, Jase is a thief, and kind of refers to the cat and mouse game that Jase and Cassie play in the book. They're both making strategic steps around each other, because even though they become friendly, they're both still committed to their own causes and kind of outing the other. And then Vow refers to several things, some I can't say. But one of which is, this is going to be tough, one of which is the blood vow Jase made to protect the town and its citizens. And it's a vow that generations of patres have made. And that's what he is called, the patre, as the leader. It plays on the vow that Jase made to everyone and other things. So that's how those titles came about.
I feel like that was Dance of Spoilers right there. Like, you were dancing around them, making sure you didn't get anywhere near them. Yeah. I mean, I think, like, with Jason and Kazi, like, these are two characters whose lives become very intertwined very quickly with each other. And the first person POV that we get from both of them really lets us see how much their lives are complicated instantaneously by coming into contact with each other, and then how they have to move through that. And I love stories that give us conflicting POVs so that we can see how people see each other, how they think about themselves, and then turn it around to see it from the other direction. You get a sense of, like, these are two characters that if they would just stand in a room with no pretense and just say what they mean, they would probably be pretty surprised to find out what each other are thinking. But they're always trying to outthink each other and sort of making things harder on themselves than it needs to be.
Yeah, especially exploring it with two different viewpoints. You know, there's that old adage that the villain is the hero in their own story. And so I kind of played with that. Each one sees the other as the villain, but in their own story, they're the hero. So it was fun to play those two together and see how they come to grips with their own world views in their head.
Now, this is set in the same world as Remnant Chronicles. That was a very successful series. I haven't read those, but I didn't find that to be a big deterrent jumping into Dance of Thieves. You know, sometimes when you've got stuff set in the same universe, you have that feeling of like, oh, I'm really missing something. Without diving too much into, like, Goodreads to find somebody who explained it to me, I felt like there were a few moments where I was like, oh, I bet this person's kind of a cameo from another story, or there's, like, there's some thread here that if you know the previous thing, then this will be a aha moment, because you'll be like, oh, I know that person from Remnant.
Oh, this is very interesting for me to hear, because I wondered, like, if, as people who were not familiar with the trilogy, as a cameo did come on, if they would kind of recognize it as such. So that's good to know.
Yeah. And so at the very beginning of the story, Kazi is sent by the queen in search of a war criminal. As the deeper I got into it, I kind of wondered, I'm like, this seems like a pretty elaborate backstory here for this person that she's searching for, who, you know, even like halfway to the book, we haven't met. And I just kept having that feeling like, I wonder if this is like a dangling plot thread from the previous trilogy, or if something connected to that. And again, I don't know. I kind of purposely didn't read up to find out. But when you're first thinking of the story, coming up with this plot from the beginning, did you always know this was something that was going to be in the Remnant world? Or did it start kind of separate from that? Or was it already like something as you finished the Remnant Chronicles, where you're like, okay, I already have my setup for my next thing? Like, what was the genesis of that?
I had no idea that this duology would happen. You know, I was just, when I began writing, I was just dealing with the trilogy, and it was only meant to be three books. But as I was writing different parts of Dance, even though I didn't know it would become a book, different parts of this world came to me at different times. Early on, while I was writing the first book and revealing secrets about the origins of this world, I looked at the maps that I had drawn. There's a map on the inside cover, a gorgeous map, but I had all my crude little maps to refer to. And there were 12 kingdoms all together. And I started thinking, the way writers do when they're procrastinating, about some of these obscure places that were never in the original trilogy. And I was wondering just what's, because there are lots of secrets in the original trilogy, and I wondered about the secrets that these other little places might hold. And there was one region in particular, right around where Tor's Watch came to be, that I mused about a lot, because I know how this world came to be, but I wasn't revealing it all at once throughout this trilogy. And I wondered about the secrets this place held and how important it might be to the insights into the ancient people who once lived in this place. But I thought it would only remain backstory in my head, you know, just more of those details that writers collect, but they don't make it onto the page. But then while I was writing the second book in the trilogy, The Heart of Betrayal, and researching the way that orphans survive on the streets, especially in crowded cities like Venda, where fingers are snipped as punishment for stealing, I began thinking about a different kind of hero who had a very different upbringing than Leah, who was a princess. She was the main character in the trilogy. And this girl was the opposite. She had absolutely no family. She was orphaned at a very young age, very street savvy, and she had to use her wit and thievery to survive, because we do see glimpses of these orphans on the streets in the trilogy. So eventually from that, Cassie was born, and I still didn't know it would be a spinoff or a duology, but I proposed it to my editor and publisher, and they were all for it. So all these ideas that were brewing in my head, I got to run with, so it was great.
What kind of reaction do you get from the established fan base for the original trilogy whenever you're doing something new in the universe? So you're giving them more, but you're doing it with new and different characters.
Well, I had some experience with that with the Jenna Fox Chronicles. I had written The Adoration of Jenna Fox, and then I did like a spinoff with a different character, and they weren't prepared for this different character. And some people, some fans objected. They wanted more of Jenna and not this new character, Locke Jenkins. And so when I wrote this one, we made it clear that this is a spinoff. And I also made it very clear, different characters, totally different characters, and that maybe we would get a glimpse of the other. So I think, I'll be honest, people adore Leah and they want more Leah and some of the other characters too from the trilogy. And I wanted to make it clear that that was not going to be the case in this book. So they wouldn't be disappointed when they opened it. And the reaction has been, you know, there's many, many fans who say they love this book even more. So I think a lot of it is just, you know, getting the right mindset before you dig into a book, knowing what you're going to be getting.
It's a challenging time just examining fandom, which is I spent a lot of time sort of looking at and seeing how fans get really hung up on what they want to see versus what they're actually being given, essentially.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of entitlement about like, well, that's not what I wanted to happen, so this isn't any good. And really, it's a pretty small vocal minority that we see do that, whether it's, you know, on review sites or on the blogs or on YouTube or, you know, yelling about it on Twitter. You know, the vast majority of fans really take things at pretty face value and just enjoy it for what it is. But I think we're in that cultural time period where, you know, the squeaky wheels are really getting a lot of notice and making a lot of noise. So it's challenging sometimes to see that. But yeah, I mean, when I looked into this one, all I saw was really adoration for the excitement of getting more of a new world, but also getting new characters to get attached to. So I always say to people, I'm like, you know, the first book still exists, right? Like, you can always revisit those characters and, you know,
right,
there's always
right.
a chance they reappear sometimes. So,
yeah.
You know, anything can happen. It's fiction, right?
And like I said, there was lots of questions at the end of the trilogy and people wanted another book. And I didn't envision another book in that world, but I knew how their world turned out. So I gave them a little glimpse of that in Dance and in Vow of Thieves. And I think that really satisfied some of those last questions they had.
How much did this book evolve? Well, I say this book when I'm speaking mostly of Dance here, but then in DeVow.
Right.
How much did they evolve from those initial ideas, maybe those initial plot sketches, to what the finished novels are?
Like I said, writers' minds tend to wander when they're having a knot in their plot. So you work on other little stories, but I tend to do all my pre-writing in my head. I don't write anything down until I'm pretty set on a story. So all the pre-writing happens in my head, and it brewed over the course. I mean, it was like 5 years of writing this trilogy. So And of course, there's some things you don't figure out, like, you know, what the backstory of all the characters are. And but it brewed for a long time, which was actually very helpful, because once I began writing it, I wrote the first draft like in 7 months, which for me is, I know maybe for some writers, that's not a big deal, but for me, that's huge. And this time, one thing I discovered when I was writing the trilogy was that I adore writing in multiple viewpoints. It kind of has the advantages of omniscient viewpoint. You get to see different places at different times, but it also has the intimacy of first person point of view. There was more than one in the trilogy, but in this book, there was only two viewpoints. And that in some ways made it easier, because I was just kind of going back and forth between the two and playing them against each other. And it was a lot of fun.
I understand the accessibility of like the one character first person, that it particularly seems to be very, very prevalent in YA, but in a lot of other fiction too. I mean, I think sometimes that's the most easy type of story to jump into, because you're immediately identifying with the person who's speaking. Right. But there are times in certain books where I struggle a little bit, where I feel like there's such a limitation at the same time, because you only see through that character's eyes. And if they are sort of innately stoic or flat about like how they approach life, I guess my example, like my perfect example of it is Hunger Games. Like, I struggle a little bit with the novels in that, because I feel like Katniss is such a emotionally low-key character through a lot of it. And there are moments in it where I'm like, oh, I want somebody that has a greater interest in humans, maybe, something here. Whereas I felt like the movies extrapolated on that in ways that I could appreciate more. I still appreciate the craft at work with Collins there, but I don't connect to that narration. Versus something like here, where like having that back and forth, I feel like I get a much greater, richer understanding of the world. You know, I get more than one viewpoint. It really, it's just like in real life, where it behooves us to try to see things from multiple perspectives to have a greater understanding of it. When a story gives me that, I feel like I have a better understanding of what's happening.
Yeah. And also, as the character, they interact with their crew, and then they interact with the other person's crew. Like in Cassie's case, she has Ren and Sinove, who are her fellow soldiers. And so sometimes we get to see Jase interacting with these fellow soldiers, and it kind of gives you more little truths that open up about the characters that they aren't willing to share themselves. So it's a really good way to see all the things that a character is hiding about themselves.
At the top, you mentioned just, I mean, how deep the thematic well is in these novels. Were those things that you were really thinking about? Like you said, I mean, you do your pre-writing in your head. Were you really ruminating on those thematic threads, or did they come out as you were actually doing the writing?
Well, I think there are certain things in my head that drive me. And I think this is kind of what it's like for most writers, is that there are certain things that you're passionate about and you don't know how they will come out in the story. You know, I never write for a theme. I write about things that I care about. It's English teachers that later tell me what the themes were. you know, one of the things which I began in the trilogy with Leah was empowerment, you know, having control of your life. And Cassie's life has been ripped from her in certain ways that I can't reveal. And so I wanted to look into more of especially female empowerment and sisterhood and all of those things. And then I also wanted to explore class and opportunity. And so Jase and Cassie are the complete opposites in that. He's comes from a large family that's wealthy. He's well-educated. Every opportunity was his. And Cassie was the complete opposite. And she didn't even learn how to read until she was a preteen. So she just didn't have that opportunity. So I wanted to explore some of those differences, which I think I did. Grief, shame, redemption. I mean, those are all themes that come out in this story.
So we talked about earlier that that basically this was your opportunity to open up a new spot on the map in the Remnant world and to go to this place, Hell's Mouth, to Tor's Watch, where the Ballenger family sits. And, you know, I was struck as I was reading this that while this is clearly a fantasy story, there were moments in reaching Tor's Watch where I almost felt like a tinge of like Western or almost like pioneer.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Because I really like when fantasy veers a little off from like the most clear sword and sorcery tropes and blends a different feel. And so that struck me, and I was really into that. So what opportunities did this new place give you to poke at new things in that world?
I had mentioned the map earlier, and I think I have the map on my website. And it's an amazing map, but you can see that it's a large continent with kingdoms that are pretty much isolated from each other. And so even though they are all on the same continent, they don't necessarily have the same histories, and they evolve differently. And in Hell's Mouth, it still has a little bit of a medieval flair. They use swords as weapons and stuff, but, you know, instead of a king, a patriarch rules over it all. I really wanted it to feel different from the other kingdoms. You know, he rules over it as a dynasty. They won't call it a kingdom there. And it has, you know, different features that you don't see in the other worlds. An underground bunker and these grossly oversized trees. So, you know, I really wanted it to have a different feel, but in the town, there's a boardwalk that people walk along. So it has kind of that Western kind of feel too. But it wasn't just to be different or to insert something, but to show that this world, as you get to know it, it evolved naturally.
What steps did you take to make this accessible for new readers who didn't know this world? Like, what kind of awareness did you have as you were even just, you know, writing the first chapters, knowing you've got to have some people who know this world intimately and other ones that are completely new to it?
Yeah, I think first and foremost was I have a whole new cast of characters so that everyone's on the same playing level. They have to all get to know these new characters and what it is they want, what it is they need. And those things are not reliant on previous plot lines. They have their own new goals and problems and agendas. So everything that you see in the world, its backstory, the settings, they're revealed through these new characters' eyes. So it's kind of getting the new readers up to speed. And the old characters are seeing kind of a new little twist on this world. So, yeah, I think the big thing was new characters. There are new characters in this story. And then, of course, you know, glimpses of some old recognizable characters and world events. And hopefully it was successful that, you know, by having characters with a very different set of goals that somehow ties in with the old goals of this older world, they don't feel like they've missed anything.
One of the things I thought was really interesting about Jace's character and his family, the Ballengers, is that they have this great deal of lore that's attached to their family, and it informs very much how they operate on a daily basis, how they think about loyalty and family and duty. And you're kind of parceling out pieces of that as the story goes along, while at the same time with Kazi, who does not have a family background, we're incrementally learning with her the events that shaped who she is, living on the streets and, you know, having to become a thief to survive, things like that.
Right.
So with those lore elements, with that backstory stuff for the Ballengers, were those things that you kind of knew and constructed ahead of the writing, or were you kind of discovering those bits as you were going through the plot or the outline and finding, okay, here's something that I need to develop out that will explain this? Like, is there a chicken or the egg, cart before the horse kind of situation?
Right. That's an interesting question, because I did do the duology a little different than I did the trilogy. With the trilogy, there's those histories too. And I wrote many of them ahead of time because I wanted to explore how history is always told from a particular viewpoint. And sometimes viewpoints, you know, had agendas. And maybe to see the whole picture, you had to read all the histories, you know, so you can draw your own conclusions. So when I did the duology spinoff, I knew I wanted to reveal more about the origins of this world through the histories, but I wanted it to meld in and complement the actions that were going on in the story. So there was a couple that I wrote of the histories I wrote right off the bat, the one about Jace's grandfather, Aaron Ballenger, and when he dies, and this isn't really a spoiler, so because it happens at the very beginning, and he charges his grandson to save the children that are with them. And so we see a world that is very much kind of devastated, and everyone's fearful, and scavengers are roaming the land. And so Jace's ancestor, Grayson Ballenger, is charged by his grandfather to get these children to a safe place. From there, and kind of it becomes a mission that the family follows ever after that is keeping everyone safe. And so we kind of get a little bit of understanding why his family is so sometimes territorial.
I get really fascinated with the idea of families that have kind of their own mythology. I feel like when you've got people who have really long family lines and like they know the names of everybody several generations back and the things they did and the where they came from. And there's this really defined identity that comes with a name being passed down.
Right.
And I'm somebody who, even though I come from a big family, like I have a far more individualistic personality. I don't align myself so much like that. And so it's always interesting to me to see people who do have that. And so I thought that was a really neat thing to explore. And I felt like that was fairly fresh because, I mean, there's a lot of people who are devoted to country or nation or some pursuit or something like that in stories, and plenty that are wrapped up with family. But to see one where, you know, they've got sort of this codified idea of what their responsibilities are and a firm idea going back generations of here's what it was like before we figured ourselves out and did stuff. And so we adhere to this thing and how much that's drilled into their heads.
Right. And there's an inherent fear that they will go back to that. So they really sort of build up their walls and isolate themselves in a lot of ways.
My father was I was a late in life child of a World War II vet. And my father was born like during the Depression. And so coming of age during that era and immediately afterwards, that really shaped his thinking. And I think there's a whole generation of people that were like that idea of scarcity and holding on to things and, you know, never letting go of stuff because you never knew when everything would disappear. It shaped them. And so when I was reading the Ballenger family history, I had that thought. I was like, this is the story of a family that came up in incredible hardship and absolutely refused to forget that afterwards.
Right.
No matter how privileged they might be in their current environment, the bedrock of their own identity and understanding is that safety is kind of an illusion and that they have to continuously fight to maintain it.
Right. And it can also put them in a prison of sorts, too. My parents were Depression era children, too. And there were some things that they just, you know, they wouldn't spend money on themselves. They grew up extremely poor. And even when they finally were able to put a little money away, they were never, ever extravagant because they always remembered.
Yeah, that idea that scarcity is just around the corner never leaves you after you have that kind of feeling,
right,
I think. Yeah.
Right.
We've definitely mentioned this early on, but I mean, to be more explicit about it, I mean, the romance element of this story is very forefront. I think of it as a slow burn because Jase and Kazi together is definitely an uneasy alliance from the very beginning. But the story doesn't take very long before we see those characters put together and having to interact. Like you mentioned, that they essentially end up chained to each other and mm-hmm. walking through a difficult terrain, escaping some people, which forces them to reconfigure their idea of each other based on their first impressions. Establishing this kind of romance, and I mean, I think enemies to lovers is definitely like a, you know, a trope that we see often in all genres of fiction, but particularly
right.
seems to be I mean, I see people mention it all the time in the YA circles, you know, that they're like, this is my jam. This is the kind of thing
right,
that I'm here
right.
for. Constructing that and making that work when you know that, like, if the romance doesn't work, the story doesn't work, right? For these kinds of stories and these kinds of readers, what methodologies did you use to make those characters spark on the page, to make that romance and the development and obstacles that they face, you know, feel both real and challenging and, you know, to make people hurt a little bit to get to what they like?
I think if each character had been this cardboard character that the other one pictured in their head, it wouldn't have worked. But I think at their core, Jase and Kazi both are very moral. They have a very strong moral sense and a sense of justice and kindness. And even though they aren't attributing it to the other person, it's kind of thrown in their face and they have to see it. And so I think that's kind of as these little bits come about and you see the little kindnesses and they see the kindnesses and the things that they do for each other, sometimes reluctantly, but they do it because, one, they have to, and then eventually because they want to. So I think that is kind of the slow burn. You're waiting for them to see the humanity in each other.
One of the things that I noted There's so many conflicts between these two characters because they come from very different backgrounds and they have different allegiances. And those allegiances are very much at odds when they encounter each other. But like you said, like, they're deeply moral. They're both deeply loyal. I mean, Kazi is loyal to her queen and to her compatriots. Jase is intensely loyal to his family, but also to all of the residents of Hell's Mouth and to all the people that he feels it's his job to protect. You know, and they both have this mistrust of their own emotions, that what they see in the other person surprises them and keeps them off balance a lot of the time. And they're not, neither of them seems to be used to that feeling. That's what makes that back and forth between the POVs really fun.
Yeah, I think they think it makes them a traitor to their cause. Like, oh, this person stands for this and this and this. And if I end up liking them, I will be a traitor to my own kind. And somehow they have to find that middle ground, which is sadly lacking so much today. they have to find that middle ground of their compassions, their kindnesses, the goodness that they can rise to. And there was one part in, okay, this is going to be a spoiler, but I'm going to say it anyway. It's not a big spoiler. But there's one part in the story where Jase and Kazi are on the run, and she notices his eyes and how beautiful they are. And she said, I never noticed his eyes before, because until he was kind and I saw his kindness, the color of his eyes didn't matter.
Yes, I really, really like, I remember that section well, and I really liked that.
Yeah, so there's lots of things that, you know, we can't see about people until maybe we see a little bit of ourselves in them, you know, the humanity, like I said, and then we can begin noticing other things about them too.
And I want to ask a question about, this is a thing that that I struggle with. I mean, I'm a 41-year-old guy reading young adult stuff sometimes for the show. And something that I struggle with sometimes is that there's a lot of these books are populated by people who are somewhere between like 16 and 20, that sort of typical, like, you know, YA age range protagonist, who often operate as very super competent, super capable people with an incredible life experience at a very young age. And then there has to be this balance of them, like, not acting like they're 40 while they're supposed to be having, like, their sort of first relationships and stuff like that.
Right.
That's a thing that I struggle with all the time, because, like, my brain always wants to age up these characters as I'm reading them. And I'm aware that it's part of that's my own bias going in, because I remember being 18 and being a complete idiot. So, so, how do you keep that working? How do you do that?
You know, I look at characters, and you're right. Sometimes they do seem, you know, much older than they are. But I think the idea of a teen is a kind of a modern concept. And there was a time when once you were 12, you were an adult. And then we sort of came up with this idea of young adult. So I think the way that we look at teens is kind of a new way of looking at them, like they're undercooked or something. And I think teens throughout history have made huge differences in our history and the world. And the one thing I like writing about teens is that they are making sometimes adult decisions that will affect themselves and others for the rest of their lives. And sometimes they get it wrong, but sometimes they get it right too. And not to say that I was like smart or mature, because I did lots of stupid things, but I was kind of a very old soul when I was a teenager and analyzing the world. Maybe that's one reason I'm a writer. And I think there's a lot of teens who are very perceptive of how the world operates and how they might be able to change it. I think we see that in the news quite a bit too. So I don't have any problem with teens taking charge and doing great things in stories, especially when they've been forced to grow up at a very young age. And that's the case with these characters. They both were given great responsibilities at a young age. So they're rising to the occasion. And I think it's actually quite realistic.
Well, I mean, like you did mention, like in other eras, you know, when a person turned 18, they were expected to be an adult. When they were, you know, like you said, 12 or in those, like what we think of now as, you know, the teenage years, they already had a lot of responsibilities thrust upon them. So it is, I feel like, a modern problem, you know, when the expected lifespan is somewhere between 70 and 100 years versus eras where people that got to 50 were, you know, wise and
ancient.
Elderly.
Yeah.
I mean, heck, go back and this is the thing I've talked to a lot of people about lately, but there's some time recently somebody was sharing a photo of the cast of the Mary Tyler Moore Show from the 70s, and nobody in that cast was over like 41, but they all looked like they were, other than Mary Tyler Moore herself, everybody else looked like they were in their mid-50s.
Oh, wow.
Several of the guys in that photo are my age or younger now, and I look 10 to 15 years younger than they do. And it's just the circumstances of the time of, you know, whether it's skincare or, you know, not day drinking and smoking constantly or any of those kinds
smoking
of things.
Smoking was a big thing back then. So.
Right. It ages you up prematurely. And yeah, if you look into these, you know, medieval worlds, pioneer worlds, these, you know, kinds of stories, there's a certain separation, I guess, to they're not living with the comforts that we did, where the biggest challenge is what video game to play this weekend sometimes.
You know? Right. They had to grow up fast.
Quickly, I want to hit on what your outlining process is and if you have a particular kind of plotting method. You mentioned you do all the pre-writing in your head, but when it's time to really get it on paper or on screen, like what do you use? What do you do?
I am like a huge writing craft junkie. I think I've read almost every craft book out there. Why not learn from somebody else if they've, you know, already figured out how to do something? So
right.
I have a large library, but I do believe that we all have our own creative brains and ways of seeing things. And so I kind of pull a little bit from a little bit here, a little bit there. And I'm not a huge outlining person. When I first began writing, and I have a lot of other books under my belt, very often it was like seat of my pants. I just, you know, I heard a voice and had some ideas in my head, and there was absolutely no outlining, no writing down scenes. I just started. So I've come a long way since then. And that's not such a bad way to write. There's lots of writers that do it and they do it successfully. But Chris, we all want to know where we're going,
yeah.
Which is kind of a nice thing because sometimes it's a little bit scary. So, you know, I've gone from the beginning, middle, end kind of thing, or the character wants, but so, which is a type of outlining, to, you know, 3-act structure, 5-act. John Truby has like a 7-point system, which he expands to about 22 points.
Oh, wow.
And then Save the Cat, of course, is 15 beats. And the first time someone mentioned Save the Cat to me with the 15 beats, and they were telling me how they use that. And I said, oh, I don't think I could do that. And they said, look at your story. I bet it has the, you know, a book that I'd already written. I bet it has those 15 beats in there. And they started going through what the beats were. And by golly, I had those in my story. And I thought, this is really weird. But it's just sort of a part of storytelling. It's a natural thing. And so then I started paying more attention to these types of outlining methods. But there's some things that are very helpful in hindsight knowing. In Save the Cat, they have like the whiff of death and some of those things. And it's like, oh, yeah, but I can't write towards that. And so I've kind of over time, I've molded about 13 beats that I know will be in my story. They're molded to work with my own creative brain. And there are things that I want to think about as I'm writing. So it is sort of a method of outlining. I also, as scenes happen, I write them down on post-it notes and I have like a whiteboard and I put them on the whiteboard where I think they might happen. To me, that's a very organic way of outlining. You can move the post-it notes around, get rid of them, change them. I feel like it flows with the story that way. I will periodically, as I'm writing the story, I will regroup, look and say, what is your midpoint going to be? Is it going to be this scene or this scene? Because it can vary. And I think sometimes there's like this strict adherence, like this has to happen on this page, this has to happen on that page. And I have my own ideas of when things have to happen because I know about how long my books are going to be usually because I'm a long writer and I'm usually trying to dial it back if at all possible. So, you know, like the inciting incident, you want to have at least in my books, page 50 or before. And sometimes it's, you know, at the very first chapter. So there's just certain things, certain points that I look for, like a sympathetic moment that has to happen in the setup, because my characters are very often flawed and sometimes not nice, but I want to have that moment where you could get a glimpse of their humanity, their own fears. So those are some of the things I try to always remember will go into my book. So yeah, I have certain things that I keep in mind as I'm writing.
Well, I think the nice thing, too, is when you know common structure and can see these kind of beats, the better you know them, the more you can subvert them, too.
Right. For instance, like after the climax, one thing I've begun adding is usually we have the climax and the resolution. And so I have the aftermath because I think it's really important to have. And it could just be the way my brain thinks that I have to have this extra thing in there. But, you know, the aftermath is immediately after the great big battle, the great showdown, whatever it is, so that we can see the losses and the gains, because there's never a complete win. You always have things that you lose, too. So I try to show the direct consequences of this great battle or showdown, whatever it might be. And then moving into the resolution where you have, you're tying up loose ends, you know, all those threads that you've planted, you know, all through these pages. And now you have to belly up to the bar and pay. So, and then finally, like in the final scene, I think in Save the Cat, they call it, the final image, but I kind of focus more on characters and relationships. And so I will have a final kind of a mini climax and sort of the emotional climax of the reader will get this, an extra glimpse of the emotional journey that the characters have been through.
I always appreciate it when a story takes that extra step to give you something more to chew on at the end of it. You know, film can give you a little bit more of an abrupt ending or cut out, you know, at the earliest emotional beat possible and still give you something satisfying. But a novel, I want a little more. So, yeah, I like when that's there.
I try to do that. In the trilogy, I worried readers to death with how it was ending, down to the very last page, and then I gave them that extra little bump. So hopefully I did that in Vow of Thieves too.
As we wrap up here, you know, as I noted, this book is coming out on August 6th. Where should people be following you online to keep up with your work, find out when new things are coming on, or if there's, you know, other stuff related to your stories that they should be checking out?
Well, online, of course, you can check out my website, marypearson.com, and, I'm very active on Instagram, so I'm always posting, you know, my tour information, and I do a lot of writing posts on Instagram, so that's another good place to check. And then my publisher, of course, they go as Fierce Reads, and they keep fans up to date, too. So, and then, of course, there's a website dedicated just to this world, which is remnantchronicles.com. So you can go there and find out everything you wanted to know and more.
Well, that sounds great. Mary, thank you so much for joining me on Fictitious. Like I said, the new novel, Vow of Thieves, arrives August 6th in stores and online retailers, wherever you get your books. The previous novel, Dance of Thieves, and the trilogy that came before it, Remnant Chronicles, are all available now. So go out and check this stuff out. I am struck every time I read your stuff, the quality of your writing, the quality of your craft. I think it really stands out from the pack, and I really hope that more and more people keep finding your work.
Oh, thank you so much, Adrian. That means so much to me. And I really appreciate you having me on today. It was fun talking to you.
This was Season 4, Episode 3 of Fictitious. You can find every episode of the show at the completely redesigned fictitiouspodcast.com, along with news, blog posts, and book reviews. Fictitious is available to listen and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, and many other podcasting services. Search for the show using your favorite app or go to fictitiouspodcast.com for links to your service of choice. For updates, articles, and other book and author-related stuff, follow the show as @fictitiouspod on Twitter or Instagram. You can also chat about bookish and nerdy things with me and my handle @AdrianBuskey. I've gotten some great feedback from the writing community lately, and it is very much appreciated. If you're a fan of the show, you can help spread the word too. Share Fictitious on social media, tell your friends, and write us a review on your favorite app. You'll be supporting the authors who appear on the show, and you'll help me to expand and improve the podcast. Next week, author Evan Winter joins the show to talk about his epic fantasy novel, The Rage of Dragons. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. I'm Adrian Buskey. Thanks for listening to Fictitious.